I have many friends in the audience, so please feel free to interrupt and to ask questions. Yeah, so this is the topic of my presentation, as Antonio was introducing, called the baryons to the dark matter of the universe. And this talk will be based in this recent paper that was submitted to the archive in the summer in collaboration with Mark Discard, who is a PhD student in my group, and Jerome van de Castere, who is a postdoc. Okay, so to start, let me remind you that the standard model of cosmology, the lambda CDM model, is very well grounded physically and can explain with great accuracy a large number of cosmical data. So this is the map of the temperature anisotropies that was released by the Planck collaboration. This is the map of the polarization released by the Planck collaboration. And here you can see the temperature power spectrum. This is the temperature polarization cross power spectrum, and this is the polarization power spectrum. Opa. So here you have here many, many points corresponding to different power, the multiples of the power spectrum. And here, I don't know if you can see, but I'm sure you have seen this plot before. In blue, it corresponds to the expectations of this standard model of cosmology, introducing only six parameters. So it is clearly a very, very successful model. So the reason why we say that it's well grounded physically is because this framework, the lambda CDM model, is based on the Einstein field equations. So it's an equation that you use to describe the advance of the perihelion of Mercury or to describe the reflection of the rays of light during a solar eclipse. And here in the left-hand side, we have the rigid tensor, rigid scalar, ultimately the element of the metric. And under the assumption that the theory space is homogeneous and isotropic, then the like element or the metric tensor only depends on this function, which is a scale factor, and on this parameter, which is the curvature parameter, expressed as usual in the commoving coordinates, synchronous commoving coordinates. Now, more interesting for us for this talk is going to be the right-hand side. This is the energy momentum tensor that contains the three components. There are three components of the cosmic fluid. The first one is the radiation that has a pressure equal to one-third of the energy density. The second one in cosmology is called the dust that has zero pressure. And then the last one is the cosmical constant that has this weird equation of state that has negative pressure, and the pressure is equal to minus the energy density. So with these different parameters that I mentioned before, I'm making a fit to the temperature power spectrum, to the polarization power spectrum, and so on. Then one obtains as best fit for the different elements, for different energy densities. One obtains that nowadays the density in radiation is about 10 to minus 4 dirichlet density. The radiation in dust is about 0.32 dirichlet density. The cosmical constant amounts to 0.68 dirichlet density. And here, the dirichlet density is equal to, as usual, to 2 times 10 to minus 26 kilogram per square meter. And it turns out that the sum of all these densities is equal to what is called the critical density. Okay, so this means that universe is especially flat. And moreover, from these observations, what one obtains is that this dust component can be divided into two parts. One that is luminous. This means that this component interacts with the photons, with the light, and with the strong interactions. And 85% is what is called non-luminous, which means that this fluid or this component of the fluid doesn't have electric charge, I mean, not the large electric charge, and doesn't have either color charge. So it is also not the subject to the strong interactions. So these numbers for the density today of the different components of the cosmic fluid is usually summarized in this, what is called the cosmic pi, assuming that the universe is especially flat, so the sum is equal to 100%. And yeah, so this picture works extremely well but it leaves many open questions. So the first open question is why the sum of these three components is equal to nuclear density, or why the universe is especially flat. And this is very intriguing, given the fact that the curvature density parameter is unstable in the expansion history of the universe. So what this means is that if today the universe is flat, this means that the universe was extremely, extremely, extremely flat at earlier times. Okay, this is something that has been passed in cosmologists since many, many years, and there is some consensus that the solution to this puzzle is in cosmic inflation. I will not talk about that in my talk. So another question that has risen in the last few years is why these two components, the luminous dust and the non-luminous dust, are so close to one another in size. So this is about 5 times equal to the amount of luminous mass. And this is also intriguing due to the fact that these two components evolve with the cosmic time in exactly the same manner. They are both dust. They have the same equation of state. So this relation of 5 to 1 between non-luminous dust and luminous dust has remained like that over the whole cosmological history. Another puzzle we have in cosmology is why this decontribution from dust is so close, roughly, to the cosmical constant contribution today. Okay? This is very, very puzzling given the fact that these two components evolve in a different way with the redshift, with the cosmic time. So for some reason that we don't understand, today these two components contribute comparatively to the total energy density of the universe. Also in the past, this one was contributing much, much more than the cosmological constant. And then the last question, which is perhaps more relevant for us, who are all of us, or most of us, particle physicists, is what are these components made of? Okay, so this is maybe the end from the point of view of the cosmology. The cosmologist is happy with these different components, with different equations of states. They can fit quite well the data. But as a particle physicist, I would like to know what is this different fluid made of and whether these different components of the cosmic fluid, they can be described in terms of quantum fields. So to this end, we have the fantastic standard model of particle physics, which is based on quantum field theory and which is based on a case group SU3 cross SU2 cross U1. And that has this bizarre particle content that, again, we don't really understand, but nevertheless, this is the model, the best model that we have now of particle physics. And then the idea is whether these different components of the cosmic fluid can be accommodated with this picture. So for the radiation, we have good candidates. So the photon is a good candidate for radiation, and also the three neutrinos are relativistic species, and they're also a good candidates for radiation in the cosmical picture. And what we can say nowadays is that the standard model of particle physics can explain quite well the radiation content of our universe, not only for the CMB, but also from the point of view of deep particle synthesis. So in the expansion history of the universe, it's very well compatible with having three neutrinos and not more than three neutrinos. So things become more interesting with these other three components. Let's start with the non-luminous dust, because here we have many, many particles, but none of them is at the same time non-luminous, unstable, and produces a presence of fluid. Okay, some of these particles, they have color, so they are luminous, so they have electric charge, so they are luminous, they couple to the radiation, they couple to the strong interactions. So then we are left with the C boson, the Higgs boson, the photon, and the neutrinos. The armada has to be stable, so this removes the C boson and the Higgs boson. We are left with the photon and with three neutrinos, but as we just saw, these three particles contribute to the radiation density, not to the matter density. Therefore, in the standard model, we don't have any candidate for the non-luminous dust, and for this reason, it is commonly stated and correctly stated that the existence of this component in the cosmic fluid, this non-luminous dust, is an evidence for physics beyond the standard model. So there have been many, many particle candidates proposed that can explain this nonlinear dust component. This is just a list of a few of them. And you see that there is a large spread in this bounded space, which is spanned by the cross-section with the nuclei or with the proton and by the mass of this Dark matter candidate. So here we have Dark matter candidates with masses of microelectron volt and Dark matter candidates with masses as large as the Gate scale. Okay. So it is not so difficult to extend the standard model with a non-luminous particle. So all these particles are electrically neutral, all these particles have no color, and therefore they behave as non-luminous in the language of cosmology. Also, these particles are constructed in such a way that they have the question of the state of dust, P equal to zero, spare pressure equal to zero, mostly because they are heavy or they were produced in some particular way in the universe, such that these particles today, they become or they behave as non-relativistic, they behave as pressureless. And then what is not so easy is to produce a new particle which is cosmologically stable. So if these dark matter particles are very, very light, then they are indeed naturally very long lived because there is not enough phase space for these particles to decay. So this is natural suppression or the decay rate by the mass of the particle to some powers. But to ensure the stability is not so simple when you go to these heavy particles. Okay? Because when the mass is, let's say, 1 GeV or 1 TeV, then these particles naturally they will decay very, very fast. So in order to prevent this decay, this fast decay, in order for these particles to be present today in our universe, it is necessary to invoke an exact or an almost exact new symmetry. That can be, for example, a parity in the case of supersymmetry, or it can be an ad-hoc C2 symmetry, which is quite common in particle physics, or the global D1 symmetry, or the gauge D1 symmetry, or whatever you want to put in order to stabilize this dark matter candidate. One should mention that some of these candidates, such as the standard neutrino, this one can decay. So in this case, you don't enforce in a symmetry to make this particle long-lived, but this particle can be long-lived enough because of being not too heavy, these particles in the KV mass range, and also because one postulates two Kappa couplings for this standard neutrino, which are small. So then you have this double suppression or the decay rate, first by the mass of the standard neutrino, and furthermore, due to the small two Kappa couplings to the left-hand neutrino, to the standard model neutrinos. But yeah, but let me show this on this point that typically for most of these dark matter candidates, or for most dark matter candidates, one has to impose by hand a symmetry that ensures stability. So this extension is double. You have to first to introduce a new particle with the right quantum numbers, and then secondly, you have to introduce a symmetry that ensures the stability. Okay, so let me continue with this recapitulation of the particle physics interpretation of these different components of the cosmic fluid. The next one is the cosmical constant. And for this one, we are not even close. In that here, it is fair to admit that we really have no idea of what is this cosmical constant made of that is typically called dark energy in the context of particle physics. Because there is no known particle that generates the fluid that has this equation of state. So in order to do that, you have to do more involved mechanisms. And then I have left to the end the part of the luminous matter that is going to be the part that I'm going to discuss most in my talk today. This one is encouraging because we have candidates for particles that are cosmically stable and that are also luminous. So these are the electrons. And then you have also the protons, which are about the state of quarks, and also the neutrons, also about the state of quarks, that form nuclei, the neutrons are not stable, but when the nuclei can be very long-lived, like for example, like helium, that was produced primordially and is present today in our universe, actually in quite large amounts. Okay, so as I said, this looks encouraging that we can explain this part of the cosmic fluid. But the question is, what is a luminous antimatter? So the equations of physics do not distinguish much about particles and antiparticles. So the question is why our universe is filled with particles and there are so few antiparticles in our surrounding. In the Earth, it is clear that we have very few antiparticles, but it's also the same at cosmical distances, that very few antimatter. So in fact, the cosmic observations suggest that our universe contains many more baryons than antibaryons. So this is typically measured via this quantity. This is what is called the yield, which is nothing but the number density divided by the entropy density. And the yield of baryons today is equal to the number of baryons minus the number of antibaryons or the entropy density. And then observations of the CMB and from Viva nucleosynthesis indicate that this yield is about 8.7 times 10 to the minus 11. And yeah, so in order to explain this number, this was already done. That was one interesting proposal by Sakharov in 1967, where he showed in a very crucial paper that it is possible to generate dynamically this boundary symmetry from a baryon symmetric universe using particle physics if this model of particle physics violates the bound number, violates C and Cp, and there is some departure from the main equilibrium so that the process of creation of the boundary symmetry are not compensated by the process of destruction of the boundary symmetry that happen at the same rate. Yeah? So it's the renowned mechanism of paragenesis that I say was proposed almost 50 years ago by Sakharov, or more than 50 years ago by Sakharov. Okay, so notably, all these conditions are fulfilled in our fantastic standard model. But unfortunately, it was shown over the years that the amount of boundary violation, the amount of C and C violation, and also the amount of the partial minimal equilibrium are not large enough to produce this number. So also from this point of view of explaining why do we have here luminous matter but not luminous antimatter, we need some extensions of the standard model. And then here have been many, many proposals. This is just a few of them. Polyperiodogenesis, leptogenesis via decay of heavy radical neutrinos, baryogenesis via neutrino oscillations, apolyctal baryogenesis, apolyctal leptogenesis, etc. But typically, all these frameworks for baryogenesis or leptogenesis baryogenesis do not have a direct connection to the other passages in cosmology. Okay, so these are mechanisms that were proposed only to explain this part, but generically don't have any connection to the dark matter passage, to the cosmological constant, etc. Okay, so at this point, maybe it is a good moment to rethink the Sakharov conditions, because one should not forget that these conditions, they were proposed in 1967. Okay, so it was a long, long time ago, and it was in the very early days of cosmology. So remember that the cosmic microwave background radiation had been discovered only a few years back by Penz and Wilson in 1964. So by the time that Sakharov was proposed his conditions, it was clear, it was known that the universe was very hot in the past. It was also known that there was more matter than antimatter, at least in the local universe. Also at that time, it was known, it was understood that radiation dominated the early stages of the universe, but today the universe was dominated by matter. But as you see, practically nothing more than that was known. So it was not even known whether the universe was especially flat, it was open or it was closed. There was some reference for the closed universe, but there was no indication from experiments. And since you didn't know the curvature density, then it was not known either what was the density of the ordinary matter. Radiation, as we say, it was negligible, it was known to be negligible. And maybe what is more important at this point is to emphasize that this part, was composed by baryons. Okay? It was the only matter that was known at the moment. It was the proton, it was the neutron, it was the electron, it was mesons, baryons, etc. But that was the only matter that was known. It was only the visible matter. So this picture is very different to the picture that we have today in 2020. We have dark energy. Curvature is known or to be very close to zero, believed to be equal to zero. Ordinary matter amounts to 5% of the cosmic pie, and dark matter, this non-luminous dust component, amounts to 27%. Okay. And today, we can say that there is no evidence for a bound asymmetry in our universe. So contrary to the statement that is commonly done in literature and even in textbooks. So that was evidence at the time of Sakharov, because the only matter that was known was the baryons, but today we know that there is dark matter. And we cannot say for sure whether dark matter carries baryon number or does not carry baryon number. Okay? So it's perhaps a misnomer from the past, because in the past, the only luminous matter that was known, or the only baryons that were known, were the luminous matter. So there was this identification between luminous matter and the baryons, but today we cannot make this association. For sure, the protons, they carry baryon number, but we are not sure, we don't know actually, whether dark matter carries baryon number or not. So we cannot say for sure that there is a baryon number asymmetry in our universe. What we can say for sure is that there is a quark anti-quark asymmetry, that is for sure. There is more quarks than anti-quarks, and the asymmetry in quarks is given by this number. It's a factor of 3, the usual bound asymmetry. And this is the only thing that we can say for sure from observations. Okay? And observations do not preclude the possibility that the universe could be baryosymmetric. Okay. So this is maybe a simple observation, but I think that it has very profound implications on the way that we see the cosmic pie. So since the universe could be baryosymmetric, maybe one could wonder whether it is possible to produce a universe like the one that we see, but without fulfilling all the Sakharov conditions. And the answer is yes, but of course one has to make different assumptions. We're going to assume that dark matter particles or some particles in the dark sector, they carry baryon number. And then what I'm going to show is that the quark and the quark asymmetry can be generated if these conditions are fulfilled. So it's an alternative recipe to cook the cosmic pie without the need of having the set of conditions. So you have to have C and C violation in the dark sector, because you want to generate an asymmetry between particles and the particles in the dark sector carrying baryon number. You have to have interactions between dark sector and the visible sector, because you want to transmit this asymmetry, baryon asymmetry in dark sector to the visible sector. And as usual, you will have to have the partial thermal equilibrium, because you want to have the process to happen irreversibly. You want to have the creation and the extraction of this asymmetry at equal rates. Okay. So this is an alternative recipe. So I want to show that this can also produce a universe as the similarity to the one that we observe now. So with this ordinary matter and with dark matter, but without relying on the first set of conditions of having the violation of the baryon number. And moreover, since the C and the C violation happens here in the dark sector, they will have more opportunities to generate this asymmetry, because you have more freedom to play with the asymmetries to generate these asymmetries between baryons in the dark sector, between baryons and antibaryons in the dark sector. Okay? So this is a simple scenario that can make this job. So I want to assume a scenario where we have the complex scalar that is singlet under the standard model case group, so it's a scalar in the dark sector, and this complex scalar has baryon number equal to minus one. Okay. And I insist once again that here we're not making this association of baryon number being plated to particles carrying color. This would happen in the visible sector, but we don't know if it is the case also in the dark sectors. So I'm going to, since the Baryon number is just a U1 symmetry, I'm going to postulate that this compressed scalar is a singlet and the standard case group, but under this U1 baryonic transforms such that the Baryon number is equal to minus one. Okay, I'm going to assume also that we have a Dirac fermion, I'm going to call N, that has a Baryon number equal to plus one, with opposite number, opposite Baryon number at this compressed scalar. Then, as usual, we're going to have the standard model quarks that have a Baryon number equal to 1/3 with the corresponding quantum numbers on the standard model case group. And for simplicity, I'm going to assume that Baryon number is conserved. It is not the crucial ingredient for the model to work, but it's just to make it more distinct or more to emphasize the differences with respect to the standard Sakharov conditions. And then a quark anti-quark asymmetry can be generated, as I said before, with this new, this revised Sakharov conditions. EC and CP is violating the dark sector because these processes would generate more N than anti-N. And one can achieve that in a similar way of leptogenesis with a decay of heavy particle that generates an asymmetry between N and anti-N. Also, we need these portal interactions between dark sector and the visible sector, and this will achieve via what is called the neutron portal, where this Dirac fermion couples to the quarks in this way. Okay? So it's called the neutron portal because this particle has exactly the same quantum numbers as the neutron, and therefore this term is a gauge invariant, and basically what happens is that the adonesis, or after the QCD transition, then this term will generate a mixing between the neutron and then this dark fermion. That sometimes called like a dark neutron or a mirror neutron. So this one portal, as we're going to see later, transmits the asymmetry that we have generated here in N and anti-N to the visual sector, and then this asymmetry will generate a quark anti-quark asymmetry, which is what we want. And of course, we have to have the departure from the thermal equilibrium. So what is the role of the complex scalar? Because here I have not mentioned the complex scalar. So the role of this complex scalar is related to this last condition. So the asymmetry in chi will ensure the conservation of the Baryon number throughout the whole history of the universe. And how can you get this asymmetry in chi, which is identical to asymmetry in N? But for example, if you need the asymmetry in N, get the decay of a heavy particle. Okay, so you have the heavy particle that decays into N and chi, plus all the loops, and then this decays is out of frequent decays, the one loop and the trivial interference, which generate an asymmetry in N. But since this particle carries zero Baryon number, in order to preserve the Baryon number in the whole cosmological history, this particle has to have the corresponding asymmetry. Okay, such that in the whole cosmological history, the Baryon number is conserved. But more interestingly, this particle is a scalar. This particle carries Baryon number, and this particle cannot take into anything. And cannot take into anything due to the conservation of the Baryon number. So in this scheme, we have a correspondence between the existence of a quark and the quark asymmetry, or you want the existence between the baryon asymmetry in the visual sector and the stability of dark matter. And remember, I said before that most dark matter models, they have to impose a new symmetry to stabilize dark matter. In this framework, this symmetry is an old symmetry. This symmetry is just the Baryon number. Okay. So this is the same thing, but explained in pictures. So here is the initial state of our scenario, where...
En la parte anterior tiene que haber una parte imaginaria también, ¿verdad?
Perdón, ¿en qué?
En ahí tiene que haber una parte imaginaria.
Aquí, This is what is the convex scalar, yeah. Which is this one, I mean the chi star. Yeah. So this is the picture that we have in mind. So this is the initial state. So let's assume as initial condition that you have already this asymmetry between n and anti-n. This has to be generated dynamically, but one can do it via this decay of these heavy particles. I will not talk about that today in this talk because it's still work in preparation, but it can be generated. And then since we're assuming that the boundary number is conserved by all the processes and is conserved from the initial time, then there might be this asymmetry here between chi and chi star that compensates exactly the asymmetry between n and n bar. And initially, our visible sector is symmetric. So there is equal number of quarks and antiquarks. So here, by the way, in blue, I am representing the particle species that have positive baryon number and in, I don't know, this is yellow, I guess, yeah, yellow, the particles that have negative baryon number. And the total blue area is equal to the total yellow area. So baryon number is equal to zero in initial state. Now, all these processes preserve baryon number. And here, what is happening basically is that the asymmetry in the ends is leaked to the visible sector via this neutron portal. So, this creates ultimately an excess of quarks over antiquarks because you have an excess of n over anti-n. And then these particles, in the simplest framework, they will just annihilate with one another and will leave a remnant of chis. And here again, the number of chis is equal to the number of the quarks because the baryon number must be conserved. So these particles have positive baryon number, these particles have negative baryon number, and then, yeah, since they have equal number densities, equal numbers, and since this particle is not scalar, it cannot decay into quarks. And yeah, so here is the picture. You have the quark and the quark asymmetry. You have here this remnant dark matter population stable due to the same reason why the proton is stable. And in order to produce a universe like the one that we observe with the quark and the quark symmetry and with dark matter, we didn't have to postulate baryon relations. So you don't need the standard conditions. You can do it in this alternative way with additional interest that you automatically produce dark matter, which is stable. Of course, you can still have the standard conditions that will be a different picture, but it's an alternative picture. Okay? So it's not Sakharov is not unique. This is alternative that I insist as a plus you have this prediction of a stable dark matter particle. Okay, so this is the simplest scenario. Things are a little bit more complicated in practice, or could be more complicated in practice, because typically all these processes happen at high temperatures. Actually, we're going to see later that this process typically will happen, must happen at high temperatures because of the constraints from colliders. And in that case, typically the spirons are in thermal equilibrium, and there will be some exchange of quarks, of quark asymmetry, electron asymmetry via the spirons. But still, the picture is not changing significantly, only that we have this new portal between the quark sector and neutron sector. The initial state is the same. And for simplicity, we're going to assume that neutron portal is strong enough to bring the dark sector baryons into thermal equilibrium, because otherwise we have a temperature in the dark sector which is an independent function, so that this will have one temperature, which is the temperature of the visible sector. That's a technical detail, just to make things simpler. And also we're going to assume that these scatterings that would transmit baryons from this sector to this sector actually suppress, so that here you have this portal. But again, it's like a technical detail just to make things simpler. So anyway, this is our initial condition. These are our portals. And okay, what is happening here? I think that I'm missing one slide. Yeah, so I'm missing one slide. Ah, disaster. And basically we have this one, but here what is happening is that the asymmetry that is leaked from the ends to the visible sector will be distributed between the quarks and the electrons, via the spirons. But still at the end, you will have a quark and the quark asymmetry And you will also have electron and electron symmetry. But still, you have a similar conclusions that you have the quark and the quark asymmetry, as we observe, and you will have stable dark matter due to the baryon number conservation, or in this case, let us say, due to the B minus L conservation. Okay, so this is the evolution of different deals with the tempestra. So here, as initial condition, we have that the yield of fermions, dark sector fermions, is equal to 2 times the yield of dark sector scales, just because of the number of degrees of freedom. And here, in solid lines, we have illustrated the yields of the asymmetries of different particle species. The yield of the asymmetries in dark matter particles, chi and chi star, the asymmetry in the dark set of fermions, in an N bar, the asymmetry between quark and antiquark, and here you have the asymmetries between lepton and antilepton. So let's see more precisely how this mechanism works. So at the initial time, the asymmetry that we have initially in N, so remember that initially we have an asymmetry in N, which is equal to asymmetry in chi. The dark sector is baryon symmetric, but you have an asymmetry in N and in chi. And the visible sector is totally symmetric. Okay? So the asymmetry in the quarks and the asymmetry in the leptons are both equal to zero. Now, very early on, there is scatterings between N's and the quarks via the neutron portal that quickly transmits the asymmetry in the N's to the asymmetry in the quarks, which is basically this leaking here that I was mentioning before. And this is calculable, what is the asymmetries that we
get initially. How do you get the part that the leptons? Do you have leptoquarks or something like that?
No, the leptons is because of the spiral. So here should be another. Okay, you wait a second, maybe I have it here. No, I don't have it here. Ah, sorry. Is because here the spirons, if this happens at high temperatures, will transmit asymmetry quarks to asymmetry leptons.
I don't know what they are those. I mean, spirons? I never heard. Sorry.
Which are those? The leptons?
Uh-huh.
Leptons would be electrons, positrons, neutrinos, antineutrinos.
Yeah, sure.
But this one is not measured. But this one is not measured. Yeah. That is what you want to say. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. The interaction you said, what is that? I mean, what?
The sphalerons.
Sphalerons. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's the interaction.
Yes, yeah, this number two phase interactions that are in equilibrium at high temperatures. And here, typically, will happen that this happens at high temperatures. But if it happens at low temperatures, if it happens, let's say, at the 10 GeV, when the spirons are out of equilibrium, then there is no leaking or there is no communication between quarks and leptons, apart from leptoquarks. But in a setup, there is no communication. And then all the asymmetry in the ends will be leaked all into the quarks without any reprocessing, without any reconversion into electron asymmetry. So the electron asymmetry here, we don't know what it is. We don't care. Well, we don't care because we have not measured it. Ultimately, hopefully, we'll care. Okay? Okay, so initially we have this leaking of the asymmetry in N's into quarks, into leptons. And then there is a second moment of interest for us, which is when this hidden sector fermion decays into quarks via, again, the neutron portal. So this further increases the quark antiquark asymmetry, and this one is calculable, what is the present quark antiquark asymmetry in terms of the initial asymmetry in dark set of fermions. And typically, these decays happen quite late, let's say at 2 GeV, 5 GeV, whatever. Depends on what is the strength of the neutron portal. I will address that later. And then typically these decays occur when the spirons are out of equilibrium. So in this case, this transmission, or this decays, will transmit asymmetry to the quarks, but not to the leptons. Okay? So the asymmetry in the leptons becomes frozen, as you can see here in the yellow line, but the asymmetry in the quarks increases a little bit.
One general question, I mean, where do you have CP violation here? Because you need, obviously, CP violation. Where do you have?
Yeah, CP violation, you have, because you have CP violation, okay? And in this case, parity is conserved, okay? Because here everything is scalars, and so the CP violation is ensured. It's ensured. But anyway, the CP violation has to happen here, that is true, it has to happen here, right, in order to generate dynamically this asymmetry in A. So in order to generate dynamically this picture, we have to have CP violation in this
The coupling has to be imaginary.
It has to be complex, indeed. Yeah. This coupling has to be complex. And also you have to have here several generations of phis, okay? For the same reason, because if you only have one generation, then there is no CP symmetry.
What is the expected mass of phi? Sorry.
What is that?
The expected mass of phi, TV scale or?
Typically, we're going to put it a bit heavier. That is because here this asymmetry is generated at the while loop level. So if we want to generate the asymmetry, which is the one that we see in the course, it's going to have to be heavy. But again, compared to leptogenesis, if that is what you have in mind, yeah, we have more flexibility because in leptogenesis, we have this lower limit of 10 to 9 GeV because you want to connect two neutrino masses. Okay. So now here, everything is hidden sector. So here, there is no constraint. So here, you can play with the pseudo Yukawa couplings, you can play with the masses, and you have much more freedom to generate the asymmetry that you want to generate. And the asymmetry that you want to generate is given here. Okay? Do you know what is the quark asymmetry today? And this tells you what is the initial asymmetry in N that you have to generate. And this is only constraint. Okay? That's only constraint. You want to generate an asymmetry in N, which is that one, the one corresponding to the final quark asymmetry. But I insist that here you don't have the constraint for neutrino masses. So you have much more freedom. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
No, thanks to you. Okay. Okay, so this is everything I have to say about the asymmetries, because this is the number that we want to reproduce. There is also this asymmetry in the leptons, but this one we cannot measure it, so it's not of interest at the moment. But this can be calculable, and it's also related to the initial asymmetry via this quantity, and related to the quark asymmetry via whatever factor that comes here, but it can be also calculable. Okay, so now let's turn to the total yields. So this is the yield of chi, which is our Tamatar candidate. The stability, I insist, is ensured by the baryon number conservation. And the abundance here of chi's freeze out at some temperature. This is the standard freeze out by annihilations into some other species. This is basically the formalism that was developed or refined by Gondolo and Gelmini. And in a secondary sector, so it's not visible sector particles, everything happens in the hidden sector. And then one can calculate what is the abundance of these Tamatar particles today as a function of the Tamatar mass and as a function of the yield of chi plus chi star, which is this dotted solid line, dotted dash line at the time of the freeze out. But now, how to relate the yield at the time of the freeze out with initial conditions? We have two possibilities. The first possibility is when all the chi stars are annihilated. Okay, so at the end, you only have dark matter in the form of chi, which is totally asymmetric. There is no chi star. Okay? There is no antiparticles, there's only particles. So in this case, it is clear that the total number of particles that you have here at freeze out will be equal to the asymmetry in these particles that you get at freeze out because there is no chi star, and the asymmetry that you have in chi's corresponds to the initial asymmetry. Okay? And that is because we have assumed there is no washout of the asymmetry because we have turned off these interactions. Of course, this can be modified. There are many, many versions of this story, but it's just the simplest one. I just to illustrate how one can reproduce the observations without imposing or without addressing or without invoking the Sakharov conditions. Okay, and yeah, so at the end, this is the numbers. So you can relate the final yield with initial yield in dead time. And remember that the asymmetry in the quarks, that is what we measure in cosmic observations, is related to the same quantity.
Another question.
Yes, please.
In all this, you need to have a phaleron, so you need to have a high temperature. What
yes.
type of temperature do you think for your model?
Yeah, this is depends on what is the mass of this phi. Okay, depends on what is the mass of this phi. Yeah. Because here, at least if you start with this picture here, the one that I have here on the slide, this with the spherons will be correct as long as the temperature is bigger than 130 GeV, which is when the spherons come out of thermal equilibrium. But then you have to generate this inside of this. So
you
say,
do that
you can?
With what is called another interaction. I mean, could be another interaction. I mean, it's not necessary to have spherons, right?
Yeah. I mean, this spherons is just to make the story more complete, more refined. So if you want to work at low temperatures, then you can stick to this picture. And the only difference is that all the asymmetric ends will be transmitted to the quarks.
You could have lepto quarks or something like that.
If you have lepto quarks, if these ends get into lepto quarks, then this asymmetry will produce an asymmetry in quarks and it will produce an asymmetry in leptons. Okay, there will be here two portals, one to the quarks and one to the leptons. Directly. So in this picture that I have in mind, you have it indirectly via the spherons. But you could also have here a direct portal between the ends and the leptons. Okay. Okay, so now we are here, and as I say, now we can make this nice relation between the dark matter abundance today, dark matter abundance today, and the quark and the quark asymmetry today, which is related via this factor. And yeah, so here you see that we have two numbers that are measured, the omega of dark matter today, and the quark and the quark asymmetry today. And here we have two input parameters, the matter mass and initial asymmetry. So we can solve for these two equations. And then in this picture, when all chi stars annihilate, when dark matter is totally asymmetric, then one obtains a prediction for the dark matter mass, which is about 3.4 GeV. And then one also has fixes the initial condition for the asymmetry, which is 1.3 times 10 to minus 10. And this is the number that ultimately will have to be explained via the decays of this heavy particle, which is what we are working on at the moment, to have a full picture and to provide the complete picture for these different portals. Because these are non-chromosomal interactions, there will be new particles, and these new particles will play a role in all this, in all this game. Okay? But yeah, but the conclusion is that in principle, you can reproduce the observations, the observed dark matter abundance, the observed quark and the quark asymmetry without using the Sakharov conditions. And this model is predictive in the sense that it gives you a dark matter candidate, and this dark matter candidate will reproduce the observations, the abundance that is observed, if the mass is equal to 3.4 GeV. Yeah. So this makes the model quite predictive because this tells you more or less where to search for this particle, and I will talk to you about that in a second. Okay, so this second possibility, which is when the chi stars are partially annihilated, so the discussion is pretty much analogous. So at the end, you end up with an asymmetry in quarks, with an asymmetry in leptons. Here you can have antileptons and leptons because you could have neutrinos and antineutrinos, and we know that there is no positrons, but we don't know whether they are antineutrinos in the cosmic neutrino background. So here the analysis is pretty much the same, with the only difference that in this case, the total yield of chi plus chi star is bigger than the asymmetry between chi and chi star. Okay? So the total area is bigger than the difference of the two areas. And this ultimately translates into an upper limit on the Lambertian mass. Okay? So in this picture, when you have the spherons, we predict the Lambertian mass to be lighter than 3.4 GeV. And if you have the spherons, then all the asymmetry will transmit to the quarks. And in this case, we have an upper limit on the Lambertian mass, which is about 5 GeV. Okay, so this is fun, but we like to have functional tests because at the end of the day, what we have achieved a few, in my opinion, interesting aspects, like the prediction of the existence of a Lambertian particle. I mean, this correlation of this correlation between the existence of a quark and the quark symmetry and the existence of dark matter, but we like to have something that could be tested at colliders or international experiments, not just in cosmology.
Where do you put some conditions about the washout parameter? I mean,
yeah, the condition is here. The condition is here. And that is because if this portal is big, if this portal is open, then this asymmetry, since you have here also this portal that equilibrates both sectors, and this one is needed because you want to have a freeze out. You want to have freeze out, so you have to have this portal. Then if you also have this portal, this could transmit totally the asymmetry between chi and chi star to an L star. Okay, so if this portal is open, the asymmetry will go all of it here, and the asymmetry will go all of it here. So at the end, you will end up with a zero asymmetry.
Yeah.
So you have to do something to prevent a too strong washout. So here we have forbidden totally washout to make things simpler, but you will have this interaction a little bit open, and then they will have a part of the asymmetry which is washed out. But this is, again, these are different versions of the story, but the main features, they remain the same.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so let's discuss about the signals in experiments. So here the signals will come via the, where's my cursor, via the portals with the standard model. So here we have the neutron portal, there is a second portal, which is the Higgs portal, which is not important for our discussion, because it does not transmit asymmetries, but it could lead to signals in experiments. So this is the Higgs portal interaction with the Higgs target and dark matter modulus squared. It's a complex field. And you would have signals via the invisible decay width of the Higgs. Experiments tell us that the branching into invisible is not bigger than 20%, and this gives us this upper limit on the quartic coupling, which is about 10 to the minus 2. But if the Higgs-Port interaction is 10 to the or 3 times 10 to the minus 3, then you may see that in the future, for example. Again, if this Higgs-Port interaction is not too small, you could have signals in direct direction experiments. So here is a bit unconventional because our dark matter candidate is predicted to be light. So this is typically out of the reach of many direct direction experiments. It's below the threshold of the detection of the nuclear recoils. But some experiments are indeed sensitive to this mass region. And this is a plot that I took from the Dark Side 50 collaboration that was released this summer and that precisely covers the matter space of interest for us. 3.4 GeV or smaller, or perhaps a little bit more, in the case that the spherons are not fully efficient. So for this range of masses, the dark matter nucleon spin-dependent cross-section must be smaller than 10 to minus 43, and this gives us again an upper limit on the strength of the Higgs portal, which is about 10 to minus 2, comparable to the one that we obtained on the Higgs invisible decay width. But again, if the Higgs portal interaction is not too small, then one could have signals in future experiments. What about indirect detection? Well, as usual, if the dark matter is asymmetric, there is no indirect detection signals. But if it is partially asymmetric, if in our universe you have chi and chi star, you could have indirect detection signals from the annihilation into tau plus tau minus. So for these masses, to have this kind of annihilations that will produce a flash of gamma rays with an energy of a few GeV coming from the galactic center. But for that, you have to have some asymmetry or some partial asymmetry in the dark matter. And as a last comment, perhaps we can say that the Higgs portal also generates, after the reducing breaking, a contribution to the dark matter mass. So if we want to keep our dark matter mass to be a few GeV, then this means that the strength of the Higgs portal must be quite small, smaller than 10 to the minus 4. Unless you have cancellations between the trivial mass, or the bare mass, so to say, and the mass that you obtain from the Higgs portal interactions. But if you take seriously this argument from naturality, then you see that you won't expect to have any signal in experiments from the Higgs portal.
Excuse me.
Yes.
One thing that I missed was that what are the interactions of this dark matter particle with the standard model particles? You have put an interaction with the Higgs by hand, I suppose.
Well,
What other interactions?
this one is allowed by the symmetries. That's why it is
Yeah.
there.
Okay.
And this one is the only normalizable interaction.
Ah. Okay.
Or the interaction that
So.
appears at lowest order.
Okay, so
You have
all our interactions are with loops and all that, right? This is the
you
only.
have, well, not with loops. Maybe I was not very precise. You have interactions. Okay, let me discuss this. Well, okay. So the second interaction is the neutron portal that, as said before, will
Yeah,
give
right.
you after the symmetry break. This one is not normalizable, but this one is present. And this one, after the QCD phase transition, will give you a mixing term between the neutron and this fermion. So now the dark matter interacts with N.
Yeah.
Now, via this interaction, you will have again a coupling chi chi star nm bar. Okay, that will be another interaction with the standard model. But this interaction is very suppressed. So this interaction is very funny because that could produce scatterings in experiments. It's also interesting that this interaction, I mean, is tw twice suppressed by the mass mixing between the neutron and the N. But you're going to have only one mass insertion. You will have chi chi star, neutron, capital N. And then this would allow you to have inelastic scatterings, paying only one time the price of this mass insertion. But still, these ones are very suppressed. So we have been thinking about that as in the paper. We have been discussing the topic with implications for direct action experiments of this interaction, implications also for neutron stars. But these interactions or these effects are typically very small in view of the constraints that I'm going to mention now in 1 minute because I'm running out of time. Okay, just is very quickly because I don't have much to say here. So this is the neutron portal. Here we have basically two parameters. We have the strength of the neutron portal and we have the mass of this fermion. Okay. So let me insist that the mass of dark matter is fixed, is 3.4 GeV. But the mass of this heavy fermion, the mass of this heavy fermion should be here or somewhere, is not fixed. Okay? That is what is here in this Hoyle collapses. So in this parameter space, we have constraints from proton decay, okay? Because
So
N are the parameters.
you're not talking now talking about an effective theory, and you don't know nothing about this lambda, right?
Not yet, not yet. That is work in progress, but if you want, I can mention some things later.
Okay.
Okay, just to show that you can have a universe like the one that we observed without Sakharov conditions and then having possibly signals in experiments. So here the first constraint that we have in this planetary space comes from proton decay because this particle has baryon number equal to one. So in principle, if it is lighter than the proton, the proton could decay into this visible particle and a pion. And then from the proton stability, from the lifetime of the proton that is measured or constrained by a supercambial candle, we obtain that practically everything below 900 GeV is ruled out, unless you go to very, very heavy scales for the mediator. Now, these are the part of the boundary space for large lambda n is constrained from P band regular synthesis. Okay. So if n is very long-lived, then this particle will decay after BDN. And then typically, the decay products could destroy or could distort the predictions of the standard BDN scenario. So conservatively, one can impose that the lifetime of n is more than 0.1 seconds, just to avoid any problems with P-band nucleosynthesis. Of course, this one can be refined, but just with this conservative constraint, we obtain this line on this magnetic space. So everything here above will produce decays that happen too late, and that will distort BDN. And everything below, in principle, will not distort BDN. Now, what would happen if this effective parameter is very light? Then to have signals that collide at LHC through the fusion, through the collisions of partons of up and deep quark, producing a jet and missing energy. So the cross section can be estimated to be something like this, where this part here encodes all these uncertainties, all these complications about the PDFs, but as a first approximation, we can put this prepack to be 10 to minus 2. And then these are different contours for different cross sections of the process of monojet plus missing energy. And this is a typical reach of quark experiments. So for sure, LHC has not detected these processes with a cross section of one picoval. So everything which is below is ruled out. And then when you go here to this region, then you have to perhaps look more carefully at the constraints. So this corresponds to a scale of a mediator of maybe 3 dB, 4 dB, 5 dB. Yeah? And here maybe this caveat that is in line to what you were mentioning before, that if you go here to very small values for this lambda n, then the effective theory approach breaks down. So when you are in this region here, you have to address what is the UV completion of this model. The UV completion will be typically through a colored particle, and then typically this colored particle will be produced in the collider, and this colored particle will decay into jet and invisibly. So the searches will be a bit different, but we can anticipate that also this region will be ruled out because the LHC has not observed any colored particle with masses below 1 dB. But if these colored particles exist, and if these colored particles have a mass, let's say, of even of 8, 7, 8 dB, you'll have more signals and colliders apart from this one. You will not just be a monojet plus a monojet here, but you will have more signals. And then, again, that requires a dedicated analysis that also we are doing now with MATLAB and with this different machinery. But indeed, ultimately, you would like to have a description of all these different portals. So maybe to mention that here we have been imposing the neutron portal because that is the simplest, but you could also have interactions of this fermion with heavy quark flavors. For example, here with a strange quark and with a sun quark. That is, if this is a neutron, this particle is called a charm omega, so we call it the charm omega portal. And since in the protons, you don't have charm quarks, you have a very small component of charm quarks, then the signals at colliders will be much different. And therefore, this limit will be also significantly relaxed if you have different portals apart from the neutron portal. And then finally, and this is basically my last slide, you want to have the freeze-out. So this means that this particle, in principle, should not be much heavier than the matter particle, so it is 3 GeV. Okay? But even if the mass is a bit heavier, then you have production via collisions of these matter particles that are in the high momentum tail of the mass group distribution. This is what is called the forbidden channel. This has been already analyzed a long time back by Jungmann and Kamenkowski. And this has been revived in latest years with different names, for nuclear matter, for example. And then the requirement, the gap result pulls out this part of the parameter space when n is very heavy, and then this leaves this parameter space that in principle could be closed. So you have to work a lot to close it, but in principle could be tested. So if the correct parameters are here, maybe at some point that could be detected in some experiments, either with correct experiments or either in pure physics, because for example, here you have interesting signals where you have a meson decaying into a baryon and missing energy. So traditionally, this would be interpreted as a meson decaying varied in baryon number, but in this context, the baryon number is being carried by the missing energy. Okay. So again, this encourages, and now we are actually in contact with people from the Bell collaboration, to try to search for these decays varied in baryon number by one unit. And yeah, so here this electronic version of the mechanism. So here, instead of having particles that have baryon number, here we have particles on the acceleration that carry electron number. It's essentially the same thing. Now here, the main difference is that the portal between hidden sector and visual sector is renormalizable. This is basically like a right-hand neutrino, and this is the electron doublet. And now here, indeed, we need the spirons to transmit the electron asymmetry into work asymmetry. So it's basically the picture that we have in mind. Here we have dark matter that is stable via the electron number conservation. And then here we have a quark anti-quark asymmetry, which is a consequence of the B minus L conservation of the spirons, and which is a consequence of this transmission of the asymmetry between the access to the visual sector via the neutrino portal and eventually to the quark sector via the spirons. And yeah, so this will produce direct neutrinos, but you can have major neutrinos imposing here a small amount of lepton number variation by 2 units. This will not destabilize dark matter, but still you have the same mechanism and you could also have neutromasses. I mean, this is again in preparation, but I hope that the message went through more or less about this variation. Okay, so maybe the overtime. So these are my conclusions. So the first conclusion is that there is no evidence for there's a second Boris. Do you mind if
I just want to make a comment, but please finish first.
That there is no evidence for the band asymmetry in our universe. Observations only show that there are more quarks than the quarks. That is the only thing that we can say robustly from the data. So that set of particles could also carry baryon numbers, and this is interesting because this allows to rethink a little bit the Sakharov conditions. And as I showed, then one can generate a quark and a quark asymmetry without fulfilling the Sakharov conditions, in particular without requiring baryon number violation. So to illustrate this, we have presented a simple scenario where baryon number is conserved and generates a quark and a quark asymmetry in agreement with observations. And as a bonus, the dark matter particle is stable due to the baryon number conservation and due to the Lorentz invariance, because this particle is a scalar, and is predicted to have a mass of a few GeV, at least in the framework that I have discussed, plus or minus some modifications coming from details of the modeling. And this scenario is not only predictable in a sense for cosmology, because here we have this prediction for dark matter and the prediction for dark matter mass, but also this scenario leads to signals in field physics and in collider experiments. So this is all. So thank you for your attention. And now I am, of course, open to questions.
Thank you very much, Alejandro, for the very nice and complete talk. Boris, you had a question, please. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have a comment. I think the relation between baryon-antibaryon asymmetry and quark-antiquark asymmetry is not that simple. First of all, I would remind you the very first experiment done at the LHC, they measured baryon-antibaryon asymmetry in PP collision at the mid-rapidities. And the question was, what is the carrier of baryon number? If it was, if it were quarks, so like every quark carries 1/3 of the baryon number, that would be tremendous suppression. What they found, the baryon number is transported either by single quark or just by gluons, because baryon number is topological structure, it's not question of quarks. Or, for instance, Rossi and Veneziano, they introduced string junctions. So baryon has a shape of the Mercedes star made of strings, and string junction is the carrier of baryon number. And similar measurement of baryon antibaryon asymmetry was done by H1 experiment at HERA, and they found they measured baryon antibaryon asymmetry in electron proton collision in the vicinity of the electron rapidity. So it was asymmetry was due to transport of baryon number over 8 units of rapidity. And they found pretty large value, about 8%. If baryon number was transported by three quarks, it was the incredible suppression beyond any experimental accuracy. So there is very intensive literature, which I cannot discuss now, but I just want to say that there is consensus in the community who works with baryon number. Also, there are some experiments at RIC that baryon number is not transported by quark. So 1/3 of baryon number per quark is not correct. And for you, it's probably important because you relate quark-antiquark asymmetry with baryon-antibaryon asymmetry, but these are different issues. So this should be, probably you should check with contemporary models for the baryon structure and see if it works with your model.
So thank you for the comment. I was not aware of all those papers, I have to admit. And here I was taking the approach that the quarks are binomial 1/3, the proton has binomial equal to 1. Maybe it's not correct to call it a bound number. That is also something that I was trying to transmit in my talk, because traditionally, at least that is the way that I was taught when I was studying particle physics, is that baryon is associated to particles that carry color, is associated to the hadrons, and leptonic number is associated to the leptons, to the particles that do not carry color. But this question is irrespective of that, because here, basically or simply, you really have to postulate, if you want, is regardless of your experience that we were mentioning, is that you have a global symmetry, call it X, under which the quarks transform with a charge 1/3, and the protons transform with a charge 1. And at the end, all these things that I have been discussing apply in exactly the same way. And at the end, we have a quark and a quark asymmetry. So it is not about putting names, it's about having a quark and a quark asymmetry. So even the name of baryon is not necessary for this game, for this construction. It's just an assignment of some global numbers just to keep track of which are the terms which are allowed by the symmetries and which ones are not.
If baryon number is topology, you cannot divide topology between three quarks.
If binomial is topology, then indeed some of the things will have to be reconsidered. At least I don't have an immediate answer to your question. Maybe I should think more about it. Yeah.
I think the best reference is Rossi and Veneziano. They have review in Physics Reports and many other papers.
Hey, thanks a lot.
More question from the audience?
Yeah, I have a sort of a simple question. It seems to me that there should be other phenomenological consequence of your model. For example, you're saying that this Higgs portal, so Higgs physics should be affected by this dark matter particle more than do you have put in there. I mean, that's just an example. I mean, but there should be, it seems to me, other ways of checking your model.
How exactly?
Well, I have to think about exactly what, but Higgs physics should be affected. I mean, in the case of the Higgs and stuff like that, you mentioned that,
Yeah.
and they have measured very precisely. I mean, not only so it is strange that that there should be a decay into these dark matter particles. I mean.
Yeah, I don't know the answer. It could be. If there is something, of course, I would be happy to know. We have these constraints in the one from naturality, if you want, that the quartic coupling must be very small. So this is why we decided to consider the neutron portal, because if one takes seriously this constraint from naturality, then all the signals are going to be very suppressed. So in particular for target detection, you will even be under the neutron floor. So it's going to be quite, or neutron fog, how people call it now. So it's going to be quite difficult to detect this interaction. But yeah, but if there is something that could be extracted from the Higgs portal or from the neutron portal, I would be very happy. I mean, by the way, I forgot to say before, because you were asking whether there could be interactions of chi with n with a neutron. As I told you, there is interactions via the neutron portal, but given the size that we get here for the scale of this interaction, like 10 TeV, something like this, then typically the effective interaction between chi squared and the nm bar, the neutron, is going to be suppressed by lambda QCD to the power of 3 divided by 10 TeV squared. Okay, that is the mass mixing term. That is a small number. And that is why typically the interactions of the dark matter of this chi with the neutron is very suppressed. It's suppressed by a factor of, 0.1 to the cube divided by 10 to the, well, I don't know, 10 to the minus 8, something like this. So yeah. But yeah, but if there is any other signal, I would be very happy to know. Yeah.
More questions from the audience? If there are no more questions, we thank Alejandro for the very nice and complete talk. Thank you very much, Alejandro.
Thanks to you. Thanks to all of you for attending the seminar.
And we meet at the next seminar. Thanks a lot, Alejandro.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye. Bye.